Over the last few decades, medical science has made, incredible gains. And of course, there was the mapping of the genome, so now we get a sense of what genes actually influence various aspects of our body. And it's, over about the last 50 years, medical scientists have recognized that there seems to be something that, throws a switch in a gene, which might take you from health to illness in a particular area. And so they've been looking for, what does that? And of course, in a lot of cases, they find that it's not just one thing that throws the switch. It's maybe a whole series of things that suddenly lead to that happening. But I know, I saw the relationship with that compared to with us as spiritual beings having a human experience. How do we create what it is we want in the physical world? And the challenge is that, especially with a lot of the new age stuff out there, that it tends to get oversimplified, as far as what do I need to do, to create life the way I want life to be created. We are examining the creative process. In other words, how our mind works with ideas, and then how do we get that to just be inserted into our physical world experience. And it's one component of the prosperity principles. And I know somebody was asking me before the service, about the prosperity principles. We've got some wonderful books, in the bookstore on the prosperity principles. So just to ask, and we can certainly point you in the right direction on those. But the idea is to look at the first book of Genesis and those 7 days of creation. It's not about God creating the world. It's about how, in our spiritual nature, we create. So last week we talked about the first one, and of course the first day of Genesis, first day of creation is let there be light. And so I suggested that as your affirmation for the week. Let there be light. Allow the ideas to start to surface in your mind. Make sure that your mind is connected to the divine mind by simply just being aware that it's connected to the divine mind, and let the ideas begin to flow. I'm going to ask Duncan to put up our next slide to take a look at the second day of creation. And God said, let there be a firmament between the waters to separate water from water. So God made the firmament and separated the water under the firmament from the water above it. And it was so. God called the firmament sky. And there was evening, and there was morning the second day. Separate the waters from the waters. We know, of course, now that the sky and the atmosphere leads to outer space. But back then, 2,000 years ago, they didn't understand that. They thought we lived on a flat earth and that the sky was actually some sort of a membrane holding back the waters above the world. And of course, it would rain occasionally, so it's like, okay, the water's coming through the membrane. And then, of course, there'd be waters. You'd have the oceans, the rivers, the lakes. So there's water under the ground. So that was the idea of this firmament. Suddenly there's a space. People believe that we lived in a bubble. Now, last week I mentioned how, God hovered above the waters. What do waters represent? They represent the unexpressed possibilities in our mind. So he separated the waters from the waters, making space for our creation. We need to have a place where we can create in the physical world. So our second day, in essence, represents faith. Now, I've mentioned before that we all have faith. You don't have to, you hear people say something, I just don't have enough faith, or I don't have faith. So yes, you do. It's just a matter of recognizing that it's there within you and allowing it to be activated. And the place to be most effectively place your faith is in God, that you have this amazing power, this amazing presence that is all around us at all times and knows us through divine mind. And so when we place our faith there, then we start to recognize, as spiritual beings having a human experience, that suddenly things can start happening out here rather than just in here. Faith is the perceiving power of mind linked with the power to shape atoms and molecules, which of course are just the very substance of the universe. The very pew you're sitting is vibrating energy at its very basic level. So I'm asking you to be patient as we go through this process. We've got 7 days. We're going to take it one step at a time. We can't take all of the steps at once. In fact, the 7 days represent the development of the degrees of our mind unfoldment, and this will allow you to see so that in the future, as you start wanting to make your life more pleasant, you'll know how to do it. One of the main things this particular week is to figure out where we're placing our attention. What are we focusing on? Because whatever we focus on is going to expand in our lives. And there's a human tendency to let the mind wander. You know, I know especially in Buddhism, they talk about the monkey mind. You know, there's the, especially when you sit down to meditate, you know, suddenly the mind's kind of like all over the place. And for example, where's your mind been for the last 30 seconds or so? You know, gee, I wonder what's on TV tonight. Where should we go to lunch, you know? These sort of things, you know, just start to pop up. And a lot of times we just need to give our thinking nature something to do. And that's why in meditation, of course, in the Buddhist tradition, there's like choose a mantra, choose something to focus on. You know, like maybe the number one, or focus on your breathing and just think about the nostrils and feel that air going in and out of your nose. You just need to give that thinking nature something to work on. So rather than monkey mind, I think a more appropriate is you have an exuberant dog. So what you do is you give the dog a rawhide bone, and suddenly the dog is focused on the bone. You know, and then that allows the other aspects of our nature to be able to come forward, like in meditation or in the physical world. Now, last week I mentioned, you know, the four general ways we experience the world: physical, emotional, intellectual, and spiritual. I know Aristotle, you know, talked about how there are these four causes. So what is the cause of any given thing in the physical world? And he used an example of a wooden chair. So let's talk about that spiritual nature. People have known that there's this sense of where our inspiration comes from. So in Aristotle's experience, you know, okay, we've got this chair. So you have this inspiration of, oh yeah, I think I would like a chair. And then your intellect will go to work on it as far as what does this chair need to look like, you know, and what should it feel like? Okay, I'm going to make a wooden chair. Now, you know, if you just jump from the idea to going to get the wood, you probably make a lot of mistakes. So you want to come up with a plan. And then you start to insert your passion into it, your emotions of, yeah, I really want to build this chair. And then you go out and get that physical wood and you can build this wooden chair. So physical, emotional, intellectual, and spiritual. Where does that inspiration come from? For about the last 300 years in this age of enlightenment, there's been this attitude that, okay, it comes from reason and logic. And there are things that are reasonable and logical as we start to work our way through some things, but it tends to exclude these other aspects of our personality. I'm 62, I'll be 63 here at the end of the month. I remember the Cold War, you know, and then there was this reason and logic. It's like, okay, we've got this nuclear weapon, then that means that the Russians have to have a nuclear weapon, and then suddenly if they've got one, we need two. It's like, well, if they got two, we got three, you know, and suddenly we've got, you know, countless nuclear weapons, and yet the thought of using even one of them is beyond comprehension to us now. And yet we've poured all of this energy into this. I know that some of you may remember back in 1983, there was the movie War Games, where Matthew Broderick played a teenage gamer and hacker, and he was wandering around on the internet, and he comes across this thing, and it plays games. And he said, okay, well, and he's playing these sophisticated games in the computer. It turns out it's NORAD, you know, our missile defense system that he's in, and the games in there are the war games, you know, and so... as the movie progresses, they need to show the computer that, hey, we're not really going to war. So the creator of this program tells the computer, play tic-tac-toe, but play it against yourself. And so it starts playing, you know, and you know how tic-tac-toe is. I mean, you know, you end up with a stalemate every time, unless, you know, someone lets the other person win. So in the computer, it starts to realize, well, yeah, this nuclear thing, and finally the computer comes to the conclusion, yeah, we don't want to do that. Maybe we should choose another game. And then in the late 1960s, Vietnam. You know, well, Commander, we had to destroy the village to save it. Well, that might be reasonable or logical, but it's stupid. You know, it's not something we want to do. So the pendulum then kind of swung the other way, and we really started getting into the feeling nature, but the feeling nature has its problems too. If you just go with emotions, just go with feelings, you can get yourself in some terrible trouble. And you can find yourself not making decisions that need to be made because you feel icky about it. So, for example, you know, doctors who perform abortions, if you start to carry forward the logic of like, well, if an abortion is a murder, then we need to murder the murderer, it's like, well, wait a minute here. You know, that kind of crazy stuff. There is another way. When people debate, you know, should I go with my head or go with my heart, there is another alternative, and that is to go with your intuition. And so earlier I talked about physical, emotional, intellectual, and spiritual. Spiritual is the intuition. We start to get these feelings about what it is we're supposed to do. And sometimes our intellect and our emotion can come in and say, well, no, I don't think we should do that, or we should do, and your intuition is like, no, just this is the right thing for us to do. Now, one of the challenges is that when we do have the intuition come forward with what it is we know we need to do, it's proper, it's right and perfect for us, but maybe not for other people. And that's why there are so many religious denominations. Somebody comes up with the way that it works for them, and they start to assume that everybody has to do it the same way that they do it. And that isn't the way the world works. We're all here to bring out the best in each other. We all bring our own special gifts, passions, and talents. Well, so in the world of fiction, you often see these four character formulas. You know, now, here I already told you my age. So in the 1960s, I got to watch Star Trek. You know, and you had Captain Kirk, you had Spock, you had Dr. McCoy, and you had Scotty. You know, now here, Spock is the intellect, you know, the logic. Dr. McCoy is always the emotional one. I'm a doctor, not a magician. You know, and then you had Scott, you know, the chief engineer. It's like, well, you know, the engines are only going to be able to handle so much. You know, the battery's only going to last this much longer. And, you know, and then you have Kirk, who is the person who oversaw all of these things and then decided what was the right thing to do. It's like, I don't care, Scotty, throttle things up, you know, something like that. And then you see this over and over. It's Seinfeld. You had Jerry Seinfeld. You had George, the intellect. You had Elaine, the emotion. And you had Kramer, the physical world. And whatever the latest trend was, you wanted to get in. You see this in Harry Potter and all of these other various things where it kind of keeps showing us, yeah, we've got these four general categories that we experience the world in. Now, last week's affirmation, like I said, was let there be light. Ideas have been flowing, hopefully, in your mind. And if you missed last week, hey, that's okay. You can start this process this week. You start to have these ideas flowing in your mind. And this is where it's time for us to be a detective. We need to sit down and just spread out the clues. How many of you know what a murder board is? I'm going to have Duncan put up a slide. You know, if you've ever watched any TV police procedural, they've got the whiteboard, the murder board. You know, you put up, okay, you got this guy's a suspect, here's the victim, here are other persons of interest, you know, you write notes to them, and you're just kind of laying it out, especially if you're a visual person. It's kind of like, okay, yeah. And then you can start to see the connections. So this is your week to be a detective. Take take the clues that have been coming to you, the ideas that have been coming to you, and sort them out. And the reason I'm making you wait a few weeks before we jump into the imagination is that the clues sometimes can be misleading. You know, I remember Carla and I used to enjoy CSI Miami while it was still on the air. In fact, it started when we lived there near Miami. And I noticed that in each episode, you know, you start to build the clues, you know, and of course they'd say, you know, we're gonna go where the evidence leads us. But there was always a clue that was wrong. What I used to call the red herring. You know, it's like that idea of like, oh yeah, well you work with that clue, but then you realize, no, it's just, it's an aberration, it's an outlier. All of the other clues build to a case, but if I had just used this clue, I would have been off and left field somewhere. So this week, I want you to just kind of start sorting out all of your stuff here and just kind of see where it's leading to you. Thanks, Duncan. So what do we want to create? for each of us? What do we want to create? And then what do we want to let go of? So as we start looking at these clues and these aspects of our life or even our vocation, it's like, okay, what do I want to do and what do I not want to do? What do I want to let go of? What do I want to get rid of out of my life? And just start coming up with two piles, you know, your yes and your no, your I want to create this and I want to release this. And let your intuition decide what's right. When I truly open my mind to divine guidance, I'll get a divine download. I'll get the divine idea. And if I believe in that divine idea and I'm willing to express it, it will unfold and it'll give me everything I need to make it unfold. So how do you know if this is really a divine idea? Well, the question to ask yourself is it loving or not? You know, am I coming from love or am I coming from fear here? And then there's another question to ask, and that's, is this me? this idea, this clue, is this me or is this not me? You know, is this who I really am? And what I've found in my lifetime is that there are times where I've got something that, yeah, this is me, but 10 years later, it's like, eh, that's not me anymore. You know, whether it's clothing or recordings that I like to listen to, you know, the stuff I listened to back in the 70s compared to the stuff I listen to now. There are things that as we evolve, we find, yeah, it's time to let go of that kind of stuff. It worked for me before, but now it's just kind of clutter. It's in my way. So next week, we're going to work on the yes pile, and then we'll work on the no pile in a few weeks. So, Duncan, let's show us our takeaways. And you've got the takeaways are available. I saw that Chris Ward actually started stuffing them in the bulletin, so I think most of you actually got your takeaways in the bulletin today. This week's takeaways, pull together your clues and let your intuition lead. What's, you know, what's the right thing for me to do? And start asking your questions. Is it loving or is it fearful? You want to be going with love. And is this who I really am? And then by next Sunday, you'll have sorted your things into two piles. What do I want to create and what do I want to release? And your affirmation, your affirmative prayer for this week is, I place my faith in God. I trust the plan will be revealed. Let's say that together. I place my faith in God. I trust the plan will be revealed. Our closing story is a 3-minute video from Steve Hartman of the CBS Evening News.
Lubeck Jastrzebski and Nancy Nemhauser of Mount Dora, Florida, say it was the strangest thing. They noticed their 25-year-old autistic son, Chip, kept opening the same art book, kept turning to the same page, and kept staring into the same starry night.
And it seemed to comfort him. And given that there is not a whole lot that helps, we have to capitalize on whatever we can use.
Which is why they hired someone to paint a huge Starry Night-inspired mural on the wall in front of their house. Chip loved it. The city did not.
Last year, this citation showed up at the door. It said graffiti is prohibited, and until the Van Gogh was Van Gone, the family could be fined as much as $250 a day, up to the value of the house.
First I thought it was a prank, and then I thought it was a mistake.
So they asked the code enforcement officer, which is it?
What do we have to do to fix this? And she said the wall has to match the house.
You know, she meant for you to repaint the wall to match the house.
We followed the instructions.
They did follow the instructions. Today, the wall definitely matches the house. But despite their cynical compliance, or perhaps because of it, the couple's legal problems only intensified. Next, the city said the mural needed to come down for a second reason.
It violated a sign ordinance.
A sign?
That was their new argument.
This is a sign.
Yeah, that's a sign.
Mount Dora Mayor Nick Girone.
A violation of the sign ordinance based on the fact that it had squigglies. It had
squigglies?
Squigglies.
Define that for our audience.
As one of those circle type
oh,
things.
Oh, yeah. Van Gogh did a lot of those. Yeah.
This is what the family was up against.
Oh, my God.
Which is why, even though they knew their son would be disappointed, Nancy and Lubeck almost painted it over in surrender white.
And the turning point for you, I think, was when a young girl offered her allowance to help us to fight to keep the mural.
Even if we lose the house, so be it.
To Lubeck especially, the mural had become a First Amendment issue. And eventually, the city saw it that way too. Last month, the mayor conceded and publicly apologized.
To the benefit of all concerned.
Today, those once scorned squiggles are now a tourist attraction, with people visiting from around the world.
Why do you think people are drawn here?
It's very seldom when two crazy people are willing to lose the house.
One, make that one.
First Amendment.
Freedom of speech on full display under this sun-splashed, starry night. Steve Hartman on the road in Mount Dora, Florida.
I got onto Google Maps and there's now a pinpoint on that house, the Starry Night House. Mm-hmm. The closing Bible verse, Letters to the Hebrews, 11th chapter, 1st verse. Faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. And may you always be open to God's guidance and grace. Let's prepare for meditation. I am one with the presence of the Lord. Allow your mind to go there. If you haven't already, just close your eyes, take a nice deep breath, and allow any illusion of separation between ourselves and God to just melt away. We are one with the Spirit. Draw your focus from your head down to your heart and from your heart to the very center of your torso, the gateway of chi. Feel that loving energy just radiate out to every cell in your body. We are open and receptive to God's living Spirit of truth. And in all of our prayer times, we take a moment to pray for others. So bring to mind any individuals, families, groups, organizations, or situations you'd like to pray for now. We include any of the prayer requests placed in the prayer box by the front door or received here at Unity of Tampa this week. And we see and know the divine perfection and the divine substance in and expressing through each of these prayer requests as their highest good, today and every day hereafter. And now let's pray for our congregation. Let us see Unity of Tampa thriving in consciousness, people, and revenues. We now see our new right and perfect location making itself known to us, and us being drawn to the right and perfect location for our highest good. The God presence as Unity of Tampa is a divine magnet attracting anyone who can benefit from who we are and what we are about, attracting health, prosperity, love, and joy to Unity of Tampa and all who come here now. And now I ask you to take the words I'm about to speak as your own prayer words this morning. I place my faith in God. I trust the plan will be revealed. In this coming week, I allow my intuition to guide me, to sort the ideas and clues that are coming to my mind, and as I write them down, I ask with each idea, is it loving or is it fearful? Is this me? Is this who I really am? What do I want to create? What do I want to release? As I prepare for 10 minutes of silence, I embrace and express the divine idea of faith in the silence. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. As this week unfolds, I will pull together my clues. Look at what I want to create and what I want to release. Am I coming from love or am I coming from fear? And does this idea really express who I am now? I place my faith in God. I trust a plan will be revealed. And for my ever-growing awareness of the omnipotence, omniscience, and omnipresence of God, I open my heart chakra and pour forth gratitude. I pray these things in the name, and the nature, and the power that we know as Jesus Christ. And I now release this prayer into the spiritual realm and know that perfect results are unfolding. And as I draw my attention back to the sanctuary, let's say together the words of the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not in temptation, and deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
I have mounted, I have run through the still haven't found what I'm looking for, but I still
thank you, Reverend Bob, and thank you, music team, Olivia. When we become detectives this week, we might find what we're looking for. Since 1889, prayer and meditation have been the cornerstone of unity movement. If you would like personal prayer today, just check the back page of your bulletin for details. And we also have people who will pray with you with these beautiful purple stoles on. So now it is time for our tithes and offerings. If you'd like to donate by credit card, you can do it on the slip of paper in front of you, or you can go to our website, unitytampa.org, and hit the orange contribute button in the upper right corner. Please set up an automatic weekly or monthly contribution. We thank you in advance for your generosity. Please bless your offerings now as we say together, divine love as me blesses and multiplies all that I receive and all I give. Thank you, God. I am so blessed. While our ushers are receiving our gifts and tithes, we're going to have some more music.
All right. Now, this is a really easy song, but I really want to get y'all involved on this one. Yeah. I like it a lot.
Yeah.
So the words, all you need to say when we get ready to do it is this or something better. This or something better. That's it.
One, two, three, come on.
I know that this or something better is waiting for me. I know that this or something better is the key that will set my heart free. I'm gonna let go of control. I'm gonna get out of my way. I know the universe conspires to bring me heaven today. I know that this or something better is waiting for me. I know that this or something better is the key that will set my heart free. I'm tired of playing it small. I'm doing what I think I should.
Yeah.
The universe has up to me. Or something better is waiting for me. Don't you know this? Or something better is the key that will set my heart free. I have it right now. I know that this or something better is waiting for me. I know that this or something better is the key that will set my heart. I'm gonna say yes to my dream. Let my imagination soar. I know that this gift is I must use. That is what I was put here for. I know that this or something. something better is waiting for me. I know that this is something better. It's the key that will set my heart free. I know it, I claim it, I have it right now. I know it, I claim it, I have it right now. I know it, I claim it, I have it right now. I know it, I claim it, I have it right now. I know it, I claim it, I have it right now. I know it, I claim it,
something better
right now. I know it, I claim it, have it right now.
I know that
I know
this
it, I claim it, I have it right
that
now. I know it, I claim it, I have it right now. I know it, I claim it,
something
better.
I know, I know this,
I claim it, I have it right now. I know it, I claim it, I have it right now.
I know that
I know it, I claim it,
something
I have it right now. I know it, I claim it, I have it right now. I know it, I claim it, I have it right now.
I
know it, I claim it, I have it right now.
I know
it, I claim it, I have it right now. I know it, I claim it, I have it right now. I know it, I claim it, I have it right now. I know it, I claim it, I have it right now.
I know
this. Or something better is waiting for me.
I know that
this or something better is the key that will set my heart free.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Un fuego.
Olivia Neal, yes. You guys.
Now that we've released our offering, let's see it doing its amazing work through the many teams here at Unity of Tampa. And we see this blessed energy working its way out into our community and then working its way around the world as more and more people awaken to the fact that we're spiritual beings having a human experience. And so it is. Amen. Here at Unity, we honor all paths to God. And if this is your first time at Unity, we're glad that you're here. We're hoping that you're finding a group of like-minded people and a place to belong. We teach spiritual tools that can help you handle just about anything life has to throw at you. We have some information for you. We've got a brochure with our philosophy. Also have a feedback card. Please fill this out and either hand it to me or put it in the prayer box on the way out. If you give us your email address, we'll send you our weekly email as to what's going on here. And we have a gift for you. So if you are here for the first time, if you just raise your hand for a minute, I'll have our ushers find you. I was going to say, I think everybody I recognized when I came in. Okay, we're good. So, Unity of Tampa was established in 1928. And of course, the Roaring Twenties. I have now a special announcement about our gala coming up here in 13 days. I've got Mary Key and Lewis.
Hey, Bob, I almost didn't get Louie up here because you're talking about all these detectives and stuff. Might wind up on a murder board.
You have something to hide, man?
Okay, we work alone.
Oh, okay.
Listen, this is the something better. You've just been singing about it. You manifested it. We're here. Now, we've got a little bit of a problem. That's why I brought Louis along with me. The problem is we don't have the attendance we need. We need 28 more people or 7 tables to come. Where can you get appetizers, a beautiful meal, gourmet meal? We're not making any money on this. And you can dance or not. You can dress up or not. It's a time to come by yourself, to come with a partner, to come with a group of friends. It's $35, but Louis got connections. That's why I hang around with him. And if you can afford at least $20 for yourself to buy a ticket, then we've got a friend in Chicago that's going to pay for the rest. Okay, so let us know. We're going to be back there selling.
I don't dance. Okay, let's cut the niceties here. Let me explain something to you people. The way I see it is you got one of two choices. Number one, you can go back there, buy tickets to this ball, and whatever this ball is called, flapper ball.
It's a
speakeasy in the flapper ball. So you can do that, you can have a great time, and you can face the music there. Or your second choice, for those of you who are not quite as educated as to get the point I'm trying to make here, is you could face the music with Alice. And Alvon, could you let these people know what kind of music Alice plays? Exactly. Not quite as pleasant as Elliot in the band. So why don't you do the right thing? This lovely lady and I will be back there selling tickets at the end of this service that we have here. Come back there, buy the tickets, enjoy yourself, face the music, and one other thing. Me and Alice, we'd really appreciate it.
Now, we have an update on our move. I'm going to have Margaret, our board president, come up and just fill you in on that.
Hello, hello.
Good morning.
This or something better? You know, we all, hopefully, you have embraced the concept of the universe works in its great ways. As many of you know, we have made plans to sell the building. And we have a lot of our financial success is in here, in this physical space, and so it doesn't allow us for too much cash flow. So what has happened is the developer that we had been working with, he ended up, as he moved forward with the plans, they weren't able to make all the numbers work, and so he let us know this week that he wasn't going to be able to move forward with closing on the building. But that's okay, because we're very smart people. So as the board, we had already known that this is a possibility. It's always been there, and so we were prepared for it. And I hope others were too. Emotionally, I know it's a big deal. You know, you think this is what you're gonna do, ever plan a vacation, and then all of a sudden the flight got canceled. Or, you know, so what? What do? Not go on vacation? Usually you just find a different way. So that's what we're doing. We're going to find a different way to actually put the building out and offer it and make sure that it is the right buyers for us. In that regard, I told Bob this a while ago. I was like, you know, I'm not sure it would be a bad thing if Chalmers didn't. And I don't know if I should say who it was.
No, it's anyway. Okay. Yeah, no, it's, I mean, it's
that
public
they don't
record,
close,
yeah.
Because I've always held this vision that their offer was too low. I thought their offer for the value of the building was a little low. So mm-hmm. I believe that we're gonna end up having something so much better. We believe in divine order. The sequence of events during this year, some very good things have come out of that because we signed the letter of intent. We were able to secure a line of credit. So our ups and downs that the previous board had to face, we didn't have to face that as much this year. So we feel very grateful that we had that opportunity. We didn't have that stress to deal with. As soon as we sell the building, we're gonna be able to clear all our debt, no worries there. We were able to secure we were able to secure temporary space. So if we aren't able to move into a new space right away, we already have a place set up and a relationship there. We've had the decluttering team that have been very active, something we've needed to do anyway. You know, there wasn't a whole lot of spring cleaning that was going on over the years, so this gives us an opportunity to clean out, remove the dust from the corners of everything, and then open up the energy of the beautiful building. We have a beautiful space here, a beautiful piece of property, and we have the opportunity to let this great energy continue to flow. Let's see, remember that our congregation is about people and the assembly of our participation in action. So just to remind you that we have our Fall Food Festival, or Fall Food Fest potluck today. We're gonna have the sacred service teams are gonna be there to offer and show you what we have going on. We have our meditation every Wednesday and that continues to grow. We have arts and crafts on Wednesdays and lots of other, we have the book, which is a good study, one. Yeah. And you may not know, but we have a brand refresh that's been going on, and so the first phase of that has been completed. So we're gonna start, the board meets again on the 20th, the night after the gala, and we'll be looking at what we're gonna do to move forward with that plan as well. So we're gonna have a program to help encourage other people that we have, encourage people to join us in celebration and help them in whatever they may be seeking. So offer them the detectiveness that we have to offer here and the fellowship that we have.
Yeah.
So remember that our church is about the people. Kathy wrote a beautiful poem and shared that with us a few weeks ago. And it's true. We're the ones that make the church, not the physical building. So there's a lot to be excited about and to keep this energy moving. So thank you.
Thanks, Margaret. And like Margaret said, as a board, we were kind of feeling some ripples in the force in the last couple of weeks. But yeah, the deadline was October 17th, so at least they gave us a few more weeks' notice. Deborah's got the rest. Deborah Nielsen is also a member of our Board of Trustees. She's got the rest of the announcements for today. Mm-hmm.
Hello, everybody. Hello. We are less than 2 weeks away from the gala. Lewis and Mary are out there to sell tickets, so come on down and have a really good time. Also, at our gala, we normally have a silent auction, and we're seeking donations of items or services to bid on. If you have connections, please, you know, ask them, and we can provide donation receipts for tax deductions if that's required. Our book club meets on Thursday here at Unity at either noon or 7 p.m. On Thursdays, the novel The Way of the Peaceful Warrior is available in the bookstore. Please read through the last page of chapter 4. Now we have an arts and crafts group meeting on Wednesday evenings here at 6 p.m. Details are in your bulletin. If you're facing adversity in your life, the second Sunday support circle is ready to help. Our circle meets next Sunday on October 13th. Right after the service is our monthly potluck. The theme is Fall Food Fest. And also the sacred service teams will have information on how you can get involved in Unity of Tampa. Again, when they said it's about the people, it is about the people. And this is the way to make our congregation stronger by participating. Our prayer chaplains and our spiritual healers are available after the service in our sacred service prayer and healing corner. That's right over here in front of Reverend Bob's office. They're available 15 minutes before and after the service. There's no charge for these services, but a love offering is appreciated. Now, let's see. Please take your bulletin home with you so you have all your information handy. And if you now please stand and reach across the aisle and join hands for the peace song, prayer for protection.
Let there be peace on earth and let it begin with me. On earth, the peace that was meant to be with God as creator.